Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Win from Within, Build Organizational Culture for Competitive Advantage by James Heskett, narrated by Christopher Douyard. Foreword. John Cotter. Two best-selling books, both at least partially inspired by Japanese successes in the 1970s, Corporate Cultures by Terry Deal and Alan Kennedy, and In Search of Excellence by Tom Peters and Robert Waterman, both published in 1982, introduced the idea of corporate or organizational culture to U.S. managers. This led, later that decade, to the first flurry of activity aimed at shaping or changing corporate cultures to make them a source of strength, advantage, or improved performance. From what I observed, many, if not most of these efforts produced disappointing results, and the flurry of activity calmed down. But the interest in culture remained, I suspect, because enough people intuitively concluded that culture did matter, perhaps a great deal. Some early research showed results consistent with the culture is key thesis, but compared to the highly quantitative work done, for example, in the fields of strategy, business economics, and finance, the culture research did not seem nearly as rigorous. And for much of the managerial world, that is where things still stand today. Culture is probably important, but it is a very soft topic, and there is no solid evidence answering either of the two big questions. What sort of culture does help drive prosperity? And if you do not have that culture, how do you create it? Dr. Heskett and I both disagree with the assertion that there is an absence of compelling evidence that provides at least some important answers to those two questions. He will make his case. I would just add that a variety of forces are making it much more important to understand that case, even if you don't agree 100% with it. Specifically, as the rate of change around most industries continues to go up, I am noticing more executives talking about culture, and for good reasons. More external change almost inevitably leads to new strategies that need to be implemented, more mergers and acquisitions, more digital transformation, and more new methodologies like Agile. In each of these cases, the right culture can make the work happen much faster and better, and the wrong culture can stall or kill the effort. So, as the speed of change increases, culture becomes even more relevant. Heskett has been thinking about and doing studies related to culture for 30 years. His presentation here is not just one more book on culture. The manuscript is unusually thoughtful and research-based. It is written by someone who clearly understands the realities and challenges of running a complex organization. His ideas need to be heard. His conclusions demand serious thought. Introduction. The use of win instead of winning and build instead of building early in this book is appropriate for what is intended as a call to action for leaders to rethink their organization's cultures. It reflects an argument that culture change can be achieved in the typically attenuated attention span of an organization and tenure of a leader. Much has been said about the importance of organizational culture without much evidence to back it up. Where possible in this book, I have endeavored to back up statements with data and conclusions from the best research available, to put evidence to work in the service of exploring what has been a somewhat nebulous topic, organizational culture. For example, when available, I've cited meta-analyses of many studies rather than just one or two individual pieces of research. In the later chapters of the book, as the subject turns to leadership, I had to rely more heavily on anecdotal information. Some of it was intentional, because stories are an important part of the warp and woof of organizational culture. There is a school of thought that such examples provide flimsy, or even unsuitable support on which to base an argument, that they portray what leaders say rather than what they do. The argument goes on. Advice that stories and examples convey does not apply to all leaders or situations. The context in which the advice works varies from one organization to the next. The examples of best practices may do more harm than good if misapplied. There is a tendency to overlook the full range of behaviors in which even good leaders occasionally engage. including immodest, inauthentic, self-serving, and even untrustworthy ones. Instead, the emphasis is on topics such as authentic leadership or servant leadership that typify how few leaders actually lead. Critics maintain that this kind of writing helps explain why leaders have done such a poor job of engaging employees. While recognizing the frustration of those observing little or no progress in engaging employees around the world, I believe this thinking underestimates the judgment that most leaders bring to the task of shaping and reshaping a culture. None of us are perfect, but most of us strive toward that end of the perfect to flawed spectrum. Further, we're not so naive as to try to apply all of the suggestions made in books such as this one. I assume you'll select what you think will be effective in the setting where you work and lead, and that in applying it, you will exhibit the kind of behaviors described here. If, on the other hand, your efforts are habitually immodest, inauthentic, or self-serving, you won't get very far, especially in dealing with an organization's culture. Throughout the book, I have tried to identify organizations and leaders where possible. There is a risk in this. One or more of these will implode over the immediate term future, triggering remarks about everything from the usefulness of the book to my judgment in selecting examples. After all, one of the most read anecdotal studies of management, penned by Jim Collins, was composed of just 11 organizations that met his severe criteria for firms going from good to great. Even so, one of them, Circuit City, went bankrupt and was sold for parts just 7 years after the publication of his book. Did it negate everything Collins had found? Did it make it less useful? No, but it generated knowing comments from the usual critics of this kind of research. There are a limited number of examples of non-US organizations and leaders in the book. The challenge of including international examples when discussing the topic of culture has been noted by so-called culturalists, those who study differences in organizational cultures around the world. They have concluded that the underlying assumptions under which employees work and leaders lead are quite different from one part of the world to another. While this may be changing as a result of social networking and the extensive use of common technologies by new generations of potential leaders, it still holds true to a degree. As a result, the very foundations on which cultures are based may differ. However, there is a core of values and behaviors common to most cultures that enable organization members to manage across borders. I have addressed it elsewhere and have chosen not to take the time and space to do it again here. Nevertheless, chapters 3, How Culture Drives Performance, Follow the Money, and 8, Lead for a Competitive Advantage Through Culture, have relevance for leaders around the world, with or without international anecdotes and examples. This book focuses on the decisions and behaviors of leaders, nearly all of them CEOs. This runs the risk of generating criticism about too much emphasis on the cult of the CEO, giving leaders too much credit for the successes or failures of their organizations. The intent, however, is to recognize leaders at all levels in the organization who are so critical to shaping and reshaping an organization's culture. The title of this book might imply to some that culture is an element of strategy, or that culture should be aligned with specific strategies. In an age in which long-term strategic planning is a thing of the past, and agile organizations are needed to cope with frequent change, effective cultures have to be able to support several successive strategies. That's why I ask you at the outset of the book to think of an organization's culture as a platform from which all kinds of change can be executed. Organizations where this appears to be especially true are those in which large numbers of frontline employees are in direct contact with customers. As I completed the manuscript for the book, organizations around the world were confronted with the COVID-19 pandemic. It changed the face of our daily lives and the way we work. It also provided a petri dish for a flood of research about why some firms negotiated the treacherous path through the pandemic better than others, and came out on the other side in stronger competitive positions. I will predict the results. When adjusted for industry-related effects of the pandemic on performance, illustrated by the degree to which users turned to the internet and services like Zoom for teaching and meeting, they will show that those organizations that put their employees first gained a long-term market share, and later rewarded their shareholders handsomely. These will be the organizations that functioned more effectively when they were forced, almost overnight, to work remotely. They will be the organizations whose leaders were able to lead from the ranks in an atmosphere in which the lights were out in the executive suite, and everyone was working under the same conditions. Mark Benioff, CEO of Salesforce, put it better than I could in an interview on CNBC when he said in May 2020, "The last 90 days were a quarter of trust, when we wore our values on our sleeves." Several of the values that we will see discussed, adopted, and acted on more frequently are those of diversity, inclusion, and voice, especially for those with minority backgrounds. Two forces ensure this. The first is the pressure on organizations to recognize and respond to the global demonstrations in support of social justice, fueled by criminal acts against people with minority backgrounds, as well as a growing sensitivity to inequality of opportunity. The second force will be an increasing realization on the part of leaders that diversity, inclusion, and voice are good for creativity, innovation, and business in general. It is one of those rare times when idealism and pragmatism make a common cause for change. An organization's culture will determine how successful the marriage will be. It should be clear by now that an organization's culture can be a powerful competitive weapon, yet we rarely see or hear it referred to in that way. One possible reason is that we are reluctant to associate the ethos of the best of the human workplace experience, its servant leadership, teamwork, empathy, and satisfactions, with something as crass as competition. This line of thinking suggests that it's cynical and somehow manipulative of human behavior to do so. Those who populate winning workplaces don't tend to engage in that kind of self-analysis. One reason may be that they are busier, engaged in more meaningful work with people they enjoy working with, freer to deliver results with accountability, more productive, and even healthier than their counterparts in other organizations. Employees, customers, partners, and communities, stakeholders of all kinds, want to win as much as investors. Winning feeds on itself, until it doesn't, as we've seen. And it's the role of leaders at all levels in an organization to create and sustain cultures that are competitive and help deliver results for all stakeholders. What's new about this notion, you ask? Couldn't we have said the same thing 20 years ago? Perhaps so, except that we are at a watershed point in business history in which new generations of more highly skilled employees are entering a workforce challenged by new technologies, more knowledgeable customers, new patterns of consumption, more complex business relationships, communities whose growing needs have to be addressed, environmental issues that demand attention now. The list goes on. Some have referred to it as the Third Industrial Revolution, centered, among other things, around the convergence of new energy sources and systems, new communication technologies, and the sharing of resources. A new generation, regardless of age, of leaders, several of them featured in this book, is ascending at just the time that several generations of new talent, raised and schooled in this industrial revolution, are demanding leadership sensitive to the needs of various stakeholders. These are leaders who recognize the power of organizational culture, both as a means of creating more fulfilling workplaces and as a way of achieving competitive advantage. Chapter 1. Culture, the nearly perfect competitive weapon. Strategy is hard. Culture is soft. The impact of a strategy on growth and profit can be measured, but that of a culture cannot. If you get the core value shared by everyone right, the rest will take care of itself. A strong culture helps assure good performance. To change an organization's culture requires a long time. All of these assertions have been passed around in management circles over the years, and all of them are essentially wrong. Several years ago, I was boarding a flight to give a talk when I encountered a TSA officer implementing the new policy of engaging travelers in conversation as part of the security process. "What's your destination?" he asked. "New York?" "Business or pleasure?" "Business." "What kind of business?" "I'm giving a talk." "Where in New York?" At the Oriental Mandarin Hotel, I answered, becoming a little apprehensive about whether I was being sorted out as a security risk. What are you talking about? He continued, apparently oblivious to the growing line behind me. Organizational culture. As he looked at me, his eyes started to glaze over, and he said, without much interest or enthusiasm, but a touch of sarcasm, "Good luck with that." It occurred to me during the short flight that the TSA officer's response resembled responses that I've gotten from some CEOs. While regarding it as important, too many hold mistaken views of organizational culture. What is closer to reality is that culture is not soft. The impact of culture on profit and long-term competitive success can be quantified. A way to do it is laid out in Chapter 3. Too many efforts to change a culture peter out after an initial push to identify values shared by everyone in the organization. At that point, the job of codifying a culture isn't half done. A strong culture can support good performance in some organizations, but can cause poor performance in others. With the proper leadership, some kinds of culture change can be engineered in months, not years, and certainly within a CEO's tenure. Organizational culture and performance. An organization's mission and its culture, the shared assumptions, values, behaviors, and artifacts that determine and reflect how and why we do things around here, really matters. There are data to support the notion that winning cultures have a significant positive impact on profits and returns to investors. One such study, typical of many, concluded that an equally weighted index, rebalanced every quarter, of the Fortune 100 best companies to work for, one measure of the effectiveness of an organization's culture, produced about 5 percentage points of annual return more for investors than investments in broader indices, such as the Russell Index of 1,000 large-cap companies between 1998 and 2016. CEOs, by and large, get the importance of the connection between an organization's performance and its culture. Eric Schmidt, a former CEO of Google, has written, "When considering a job, smart creatives place culture at the top of the list. To be effective, they need to care about the place they work. This is why, when starting a new company or initiative, culture is the most important thing to consider. Culture and success go hand in hand." The late Tony Hsieh, longtime CEO of the highly successful online shoe retailer Zappos.com, said, "At the end of the day, just remember that if you get the culture right, most of the other stuff, including building a great brand, will fall into place on its own." Ray Dalio, the founder and chairman of Bridgewater Associates, the world's largest hedge fund, which has reputedly made more money for investors than any other, has written in a book devoted largely to his organization's culture that a great organization has both great people and a great culture. Companies that get progressively better over time have both. Lou Gerstner reflected on his experience in taking over the job of CEO at a failing IBM this way. "Until I came to IBM, I probably would have told you that culture was just one among several important elements in any organization's makeup and success, along with vision, strategy, marketing, financials, and the like. I came to see, in my time at IBM, that culture isn't just one aspect of the game. It is the game." Gerstner employed this philosophy in one of the largest corporate turnarounds in U.S. business history. For many years, Ken Iverson led Nucor Steel, the mini-mill steel producer that transformed the industry and has earned high returns for shareholders. The company's success has been attributable in large part to the successful application of technology resulting from innovative ideas generated by both employees and customers. The late Iverson led the company until 2002 and still serves as an inspiration to the organization. He is known for attributing 30% of the company's success to technology and industry-leading innovation. What about the other 70%? He attributed that to culture. Perhaps the poster child among organizations associating an organization's performance with its culture is Southwest Airlines. Although older generations, such as 3M and IBM, rose to prominence in part through their strong cultures, it was Southwest Airlines that captured the imagination of management students with its innovative personnel policies, when it began operating under that name in 1971. Herb Kelleher, who built Southwest Airlines around a unique culture, believed for years that culture was the company's most potent competitive weapon. It's one that still hasn't been replicated by Southwest's U.S. competitors, even though it has been more than 40 years since the Southwest strategy was made quite clear to the world by those of us who studied it at the time. Several years ago, when I talked with Kelleher in his office at Love Field in Dallas about the relative importance of culture in Southwest's success, he commented, "At the beginning, the questions we asked were, what do we want to be? What do we want to do for the world? We wanted to be the airline for the common man. We said, stop wasting time on 5 or 10 year plans. We want to start an airline. Culture comes first. What we're about is protecting and growing people." Kelleher made it sound as if culture was the primary element of strategy for Southwest, at least in the early days. I'm not sure if that was his intent, but it's one way of looking at culture's role in ensuring competitive advantage. Culture is a competitive weapon. A growing cadre of leaders recognizes that an effective culture combined with a reasonable, not necessarily the highest compensation, fosters productivity by enabling an organization to attract and keep the best people, winning all ties with organizations competing for the same talent, while also ranking highly with customers. This includes leaders of U.S. organizations, other than those whose leaders were quoted earlier, like Microsoft, T-Mobile, USAA, Publix, Genentech, Cisco, Wegmans Supermarkets, Salesforce.com, Progressive, The Container Store, Starbucks, and Costco, as well as organizations in other countries, such as Cemex in Mexico, Chateau Form in France, Booking.com in the Netherlands, and Handelsbanken in Sweden. An effective culture lowers employee defections. It also produces lower staffing costs by eliminating some recruiting and training. One recent study concludes that a strong corporate culture fosters better execution, reduction in agency cost, and higher productivity and creativity. Another even suggests that by reducing stress and incentives to cheat, an organization's culture can help reduce the cost of employee fraud, which is estimated by one panel of experts to average 5% of revenues. Better talent on the front lines in contact with customers means fewer customer defections and faster sales growth. All of this contributes significantly to financial performance. It's easy to ignore other ways in which culture is an effective competitive weapon. Andy Grove, the legendary leader of Intel and always the engineer, equated culture with efficiency, a manual for quicker, more reliable decisions made by colleagues all relying on the same set of assumptions and values. Unlike many elements of a strategy, an organization's culture is hard for competitors to emulate. It operates beneath the radar, so to speak. Organizations with legendary success, like Zappos and Disney's theme park business unit, have regularly hosted visitors in classes that explain their cultures in detail. Why? An organization's mission and culture comprise a complex set of elements that are next to impossible to replicate. In this world of high-tech corporate cybersecurity and espionage, cultures represent unique competitive weapons. They can't be hacked. Even if they could be replicated, they would have to fit with other similarly unique combinations of an organization's policies, processes, and controls. That doesn't mean, however, that we can't learn from others about how to shape an effective culture or reshape an ineffective one. Strong cultures don't always win. A strong culture can help assure good performance. It can also help assure bad performance. A study that John Cotter and I carried out some years ago found that organizations with strong cultures appeared to be among the biggest winners and losers when it came to measuring such things as growth and return on investment over the 10-year period for which we examined and analyzed data for more than 200 U.S. firms. The dysfunctional beliefs and behaviors we found when we studied a sample of firms with strong cultures and poor performance included a tendency to assume that the practices that had produced success in the past would once again foster strong performance, a strong sense of pride that had turned into arrogance toward customers, suppliers, and others, the commonly held notion that there was little to learn from competitors or other firms regarded as leaders in their respective industries. A lack of internal support for the sharing of best practices and learning in general, and an inbred management that rejected new ideas and those who might bring them to the organization. The message is that strong cultures can support good long-term performance, but only if they also encourage such things as personal development, learning, and innovation in support of adaptability, and what has become more popularly known as organizational agility. Effective cultures anchor strategic change. Most discussions of the relationship between culture and strategy focus on the limiting effects of culture on strategy. The notion is that a culture limits the kinds of strategies that can be executed. As Edgar H. Schein has put it, more and more management consultants are recognizing that, because culture constrains strategy, a company must analyze its culture and learn to manage within its boundaries or, if necessary, change it. I see it differently. Think of it as a glass-half-full versus a glass-half-empty view. An effective culture embodies learning, innovation, and change. Cultures centered around transparency and trust pave the way for change. In this way, culture is an enabler of an agile approach to strategy. It makes the leadership and management of all kinds of change easier. There is a catchy, popular, oft-repeated view that culture eats strategy for lunch. This implies a relationship that is not helpful. Culture and strategy are not in some kind of competitive race for success. It's more useful to think of culture and strategy operating in tandem to produce competitive superiority. Culture and strategy complement each other in the most successful organizations. For example, we'll see later how Satya Nadella went about leading a turnaround of dysfunctional aspects of Microsoft's culture. But at the same time, he was leading a major change in strategy away from the domination of Windows software, a change made more difficult by the market share and huge wealth that Windows had produced for Microsoft. It was time for the company to begin playing catch-up to Amazon and cloud computing. And fast. The culture had to be reshaped to foster trust versus infighting, a greater reliance on judgment versus formal controls, and higher engagement of both employees and customers that could lead to faster and easier change, including a shift in strategy within Microsoft. The shift to a greater emphasis on a cloud-based service strategy to take its place alongside an extremely successful Microsoft software strategy was facilitated by the simultaneous effort to address the culture, how things would be done at Microsoft going forward. The point here is that an effective culture provides a base, a platform, from which a range of strategies can be launched and executed. It's easier to change a strategy than it is to change a culture. In a competitive era demanding, in many industries, frequent changes of strategy, any one culture needs to be designed to support a range of strategies. This lays waste to the notion that culture and strategy must be in perfect alignment at all times. The range of strategies associated with any particular culture is, however, not unlimited. For this reason, cultures and the range of strategies they are capable of supporting have to be mutually supportive. One useful way to think about the relationship between culture and strategy is that an effective culture can provide a competitive advantage for a very long time, often much longer than any strategy. This is a particular advantage in the world in which some claim that strategy today confers only short-term competitive advantage. In her book, The End of Competitive Advantage, Rita Gunther McGrath argues that the management presumption that competitive advantage is sustainable creates all the wrong reflexes in a world in which the best one can hope for is transient competitive advantage. It's a world in which, among other things, smaller, faster, more agile organizational entities marshal resources rather than own them, and management by consensus is replaced by management governed by shared overarching beliefs. Think of an effective culture as one that provides a platform, in the high-tech sense of that word, one that is designed to foster the ability to learn, adapt, innovate, and change anything, including strategy. It is this kind of platform from which strategies with transitory competitive advantage can be developed and executed. Figure 1.1 shows this. It describes, in a nutshell, much of what this book is about. Here's how to read Figure 1.1. An organization's culture is the foundation for phenomena leading to two of an infinite range of outcomes, track A or track B. Both can produce strategic success. But track A is a successful strategy owing little to an effective culture. The culture itself is characterized by an authoritarian management style with today's ubiquitous mission to be the best at something. It may make claims to be customer-centered and emphasize employee development, but it allows only limited employee voice and gives limited support for cross-boundary, read, silo, cooperation. Figure 1.1. Two views of culture and strategy. Track A. Short-term, single-strategy success. Change is more difficult. Moderate employee and customer loyalty. Moderate engagement, speed. Heavy reliance on controls. Moderate trust. Track B. Long-term, multiple-strategy success. Change is easier. High employee and customer loyalty. High employee and customer engagement, speed. Heavy reliance on judgment. High trust. Culture. Track A. A strong culture with past success. Track B. A strong culture with past success. Track A. Authoritarian management style. Track B. Participative management style. Track A. Mission. To be the best. Track B. Mission. To change the world. Track A, customer-centered. Track B, employee and customer-centered. Track A, limited employee voice. Track B, emphasis on employee voice. Track A, individual-oriented. Track B, team-oriented. Track A, cross-boundary cooperation unusual. Track B, cross-boundary cooperation typical. Track A, emphasis on employee development. Track B, emphasis on employee development, organizational learning. As a result, organizations employing a Track A culture can expect only moderate levels of trust with a relatively heavy reliance on controls to produce desired behaviors. That slows down decision-making and execution. Employees and customers are only loyal to a point. This is a culture designed to support one strategy. It may be a strategy built around a highly successful product, an effective distribution system, or even government protection. An organization may execute the strategy very well and enjoy success. But a problem presents itself when it becomes necessary to change that strategy or to make any important change in the organization. Change is very difficult. The strong, authoritarian culture makes it difficult. Success may validate the rightness of the culture until it doesn't. But that success is relatively short for organizations on track A in a competitive environment that is changing faster and faster, much too fast for any change in culture needed to support a new strategy. Compare this with the organization on track B in Figure 1.1. It too has a strong culture, but one centered on a participative versus authoritarian management style. The mission is inspirational, to change the world versus to be the best. It is a team-oriented, employee- and customer-centered culture with an emphasis not only on employee development, but also on cross-boundary cooperation and organizational learning and innovation. The culture associated with Track B fosters a high level of trust. Therefore, it functions well with a heavy reliance on employee judgment versus more formal controls among a group of people that is comfortable with how and why we do things around here. This is a place where employees like to work and are highly engaged, leading to both employee and customer loyalty that is directly linked to growth and profitability, as the numbers will show later. This is a culture in which the leadership of change of any kind, is easier than most. Ease of change extends to the matter of strategy. A Track B culture can support a range of strategies as well as a change from one to another. It is a culture geared to the long-term success of an increasingly, rapidly changing panoply of strategies in an accelerating competitive environment based on a stream of new ideas and constant change. At no time has the importance of this been driven home more than during the COVID-19 global pandemic, for which no plan could be made. Agility, not long-range planning, is the answer to hard-to-predict events. Finally, effective culture is especially important for organizations in the startup phase of their development, in which several business models or strategies may have to be tested to find the one that can provide sustained success. Repeated strategic success, and even failure for the right reasons, validates the rightness of a Track B culture. Of course, you have the option of largely ignoring issues of organizational culture. That's an interesting thing about cultures. They form with or without management intervention. But as a leader, you ignore them at your own risk. As Ben Horowitz, founder and leader of LoudCloud, a pioneer in software as a service, put it, if you don't methodically set your culture, then 2/3 of it will end up being accidental, and the rest will be a mistake. What this book is about. This book is about how culture contributes to great places to work and employee engagement, and how they, in turn, lead to profit and growth. Let's face it, organizations around the world do a lousy job of engaging their employees. Why? Much of the problem can be traced to organizational cultures that sound great and mean well until it comes to implementation. This requires an expanded view of what culture is and how it's put to work.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.